hard to imagine a bigger contrast than that between Thomas Carlyle and John Stuart Mill. Where Carlyle is the rhetorician, the pulpit pounding, Bible thumping minister in a secular world, Mill is the supremely logical, supremely rational, cool, calm, and collected voice, writing in measured prose. Where Carlyle's prose is full of exclamation points and italics and pop culture references and neologisms and extreme claims and hyperbole, Mill's prose, on the other hand, is measured and balanced and written in flowing sentences. So they are clearly two very different kinds of authors. However, when Mill published in 1831 an essay called The Spirit of the Age and Carlyle read it, Carlyle proclaimed that Mill was a new mystic and felt that he had found some sort of fellow philosopher who would help diagnose the problems of Victorian society. Now, ultimately, they recognized that they were very different and were pursuing very different kinds of philosophical enterprises. But I'm going to argue that as we get through Mill's writings, and especially as we go from his earlier writings to his later writings, and as he begins to revise Bentham's philosophy to make it fit into his empirical observations of how society worked, Mill became much more like Carlyle, just as Carlyle, as we saw in a previous lecture, ultimately became much more utilitarian. Now, Mill was the result of a structured educational plan. He seems to have been a prodigy. He had mastered Greek by 3, Latin by the age of 8, and by the age of 14 had read most of the classics and was carrying on well-informed, rational conversations with people many years his senior about historical and contemporary topics. But Mill himself claims that he's not really a prodigy, just a result of a structured and well-constructed education on the one hand, and the fact that he started so early. He himself says that by the time he was in his 20s, he had a quarter century start on his contemporaries, and so clearly he would have been more well-educated than they were. Mill was also very much an important writer during this period, very influential in a number of different fields. His texts on logic became standard course textbooks for the rest of the century and well into the next century, and in many cases are still read. His book-length essay on liberty, parts of which we'll be reading, should be required reading for every human being on the planet, and especially now, has become extremely topically relevant. As we deal with groups of people in a society who tend to tamp down or silence people with whom they disagree, his discussion of the hostile and dreaded censorship imposed upon free discourse and the limitations that creates for a society should be required reading for everyone within a free, liberal society. As I mentioned earlier, Mill began his life as the child of James Mill, who was a close follower and right-hand man of Jeremy Bentham, and his education into the principles of utilitarianism began very early. But over the course of his life, Mill began to recognize that some of the more mechanistic and rigid rules that came out of utilitarianism did not adequately describe how people actually behaved in a society, and began to modify his doctrine of utilitarianism in a way that made it both more reflective of how people actually thought and also more acceptable to a larger group of people. And we'll see that in utilitarianism. Ultimately, we're going to apply Mill's description of utilitarianism as it appears in the pamphlet of that name to Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol, showing how, even though Charles Dickens is self-consciously attacking what he thinks the doctrine of utility is, and attacking a utilitarian villain in the name of Scrooge, ultimately conforms to the notion of utility that John Stuart Mill advances in his pamphlet. Now, it's helpful to begin by contrasting John Stuart Mill with Thomas Carlyle and contrasting Mill's rationalistic, empirical approach to social theories and to morality with Carlyle's transcendental approach. Although, ultimately, I will be arguing that those two separate approaches finally converge. But first, let's talk about the difference between Carlyle and Mill before we talk about how they ultimately tend to converge toward one another in their social positions. Just to revisit what we talked about earlier when we were looking at Carlyle, Thomas Carlyle is a transcendentalist. He believes that there is some order that transcends our actual reality and which manifests itself in our world through work, and particularly the work of heroes, those people who take on a leadership role and tell the rest of us what to do. Whereas John Stuart Mill, on the other side, is an empiricist and a rationalist, and he believes that the rules of behavior derive from empirical observations of behavior and rational analysis of behavior in order to come to conclusions. As a transcendentalist, you'll recall that Thomas Carlyle set up in his essay Characteristics the argument that the ideal, vital, and dynamic society, a living society, is one that is not driven by self-conscious, rational analysis, but rather by unconsciousness, by acting. That it's a spiritual as opposed to a material world, and that materialism, he believes, is a soul-killing philosophy. It depends upon creativity as opposed to what he thinks is the mechanical manufacturing, and that it's driven by the artist, who is superior and creative and does what he does without knowing how he does it, as opposed to the debater, who is an inferior mind, who talks but is incapable of actually doing anything. He believes it's driven by intuition rather than logic and rational thought, and that intuition comes from inspiration and not from analysis. Mill, on the other hand, reverses those orders. He still believes that there is a vital, living, and dynamic society, as opposed to a mechanical society, and we'll see in his discussion in On Liberty that he uses the term mechanical, but he opposes those. He believes that a vital society is driven by rational thought, by reason, and a mechanical society, on the other hand, is one that is unreflective, where people do not stop to think about what they're doing, but simply act. He believes that rational thought leads to original behavior, the origination of new things, whereas mechanical behavior is conformist and uniform. It simply goes along with what has already been done by others. And usually it follows the dominating thought of the hegemonic class. A vital society recognizes individualism and the importance of individualism and innovation, whereas a mechanical society follows custom and does things simply because they are customary. A vital society is one which cherishes freedom and which allows individuals the freedom to innovate and be original, as opposed to censoring behavior or imposing beliefs on people. As I'm sure you're aware, one of the things that John Stuart Mill opposed in On Liberty is the tyranny of the majority, which he describes in the passage that we'll be looking at as a harsh and dreaded censorship, imposing beliefs of the majority on individuals who otherwise would be free to pursue new lines of thought and create a new society. A vital and dynamic society is progressive and moving forward. There's always progress and development, whereas a mechanical society is dominated by mediocrity and a static, unchanging, moribund moral order. In Chapter 3 of On Liberty, on page 81 in our text, he discusses the importance of individuality in establishing this dynamic, vital society. He begins by explaining that individuality requires that one be able to make informed choices about one's behavior and actions. He starts off in the second paragraph. He says, "No one's idea of excellence in conduct is that people should do absolutely nothing but copy one another. No one would assert that people ought not to put into their mode of life and into the conduct of their concerns any impress whatever of their own judgment or of their own individual character. On the other hand, it would be absurd to pretend that people ought to live as if nothing whatever had been known in the world before they came into it, as if experience had as yet done nothing towards showing that one mode of existence or conduct is preferable to another. Nobody denies that people should be so taught and trained in youth as to know and benefit by the ascertained results of human experience. But it is the privilege and proper condition of a human being arrived at the maturity of his faculties to use and interpret experience in his own way. All right, so what he's doing at the beginning of this is explaining something that echoes his discussion in the complimentary essays on Coleridge and Bentham, where he describes Coleridge as the person who identifies the value in what has already been established, and Bentham establishes what is wrong with old practices and develops new practices to remedy them. In terms of individuality, the same practice is important. One should know the valuable things from past experience, but one should also be free to choose to differ from those past practices. He goes on to say, it is for him to find out what part of recorded experience is properly applicable to his own circumstances and character. The traditions and customs of other people are, to a certain extent, evidence of what their experience has taught them, presumptive evidence, and as such have a claim to his deference. But in the first place, their experience may be too narrow, or they may not have interpreted it rightly. Secondly, their interpretation of experience may be correct, but unsuitable to him. Customs are made for customary circumstances and customary characters, and his circumstances or his character may be uncustomary. Thirdly, though the customs be both good as customs and suitable to him, yet to conform to custom merely as custom does not educate or develop in him any of the qualities which are the distinctive endowment of a human being. The human faculties of perception, judgment, discriminative feeling, mental activity, and evil moral preference are exercised only in making a choice. He who does anything because it is the custom makes no choice. He gains no practice either in discerning or desiring what is best. The mental and moral, like the muscular powers, are improved only by being used. The faculties are called into no exercise by doing a thing merely because others do it, no more than by believing a thing only because others believe it. If the grounds of an opinion are not conclusive to one's own reason, his reason cannot be strengthened, but is likely to be weakened by his adopting it. And if the inducements to act are not such as are consentaneous to his own feelings and character, where affections or the rights of others are not concerned, it is so much done towards rendering his feelings and characters inert and torpid instead of active and energetic. He who lets the world, or his own portion of it, choose his plan of life for him has no need of any other faculty than the ape-like one of imitation. He who chooses his plan for himself employs all of his faculties. He must use his observation to see, reasoning and judgment to foresee, activity to gather materials for decision, discrimination to decide, and when he has decided, firmness and self-control to hold to his deliberate decision. What Mill is arguing here is that following custom merely as custom, simply because it is what is usually done or because what other people do, rather than taking the time to determine the grounds for action and making a reasoned decision based upon critical thinking, not only results in a thoughtless action, but also weakens the judgment. It weakens the ability to make decisions because one is not even bothering to make a decision. One is simply doing what one does without stopping to consider why one does it or whether it is the appropriate thing to do. He goes on to say, at the bottom of the page, supposing it were possible to get houses built, corn grown, battles fought, causes tried, and even churches erected and prayers said by machinery, by automatons in human form, it would be a considerable loss to exchange for these automatons even the men and women who at present inhabit the more civilized parts of the world, and who assuredly are but starved specimens of what nature can and will produce. Human nature is not a machine to be built after a model and set to do exactly the work prescribed for it, but a tree which requires to grow and develop itself on all sides according to the tendency of the inward forces which make it a living thing. It will probably be conceded that it is desirable people should exercise their understandings, and that an intelligent following of custom, or even occasionally an intelligent deviation from custom, is better than a blind and simply mechanical adhesion to it. All right, so in this particular case, in relation to what we were discussing before and the difference between Thomas Carlyle and John Stuart Mill, he is beginning to imply that adhering to custom simply as custom, doing things because other people have done them or because it is normal to do it those ways, without questioning why one does it, without applying one's own judgment and making one's own decision, is what qualifies here as mechanical behavior. He'll go on to say, farther down on the same page, that a person whose desires and impulses are his own,
are the expression of his own nature as it has been developed and modified by his own culture, is said to have character. One whose desires and impulses are not his own has no character, no more than a steam engine has a character. And so once again, this for Mill is the indication of what mechanical behavior is. Mechanical behavior is behaving thoughtlessly without making a rational decision. In the next paragraph, he describes the fact that social rules were established in the early form of society in order to control excessive power, because individuals lacked sufficient self-control in savage cultures, and so society put in procedures and models and mores and expectations in place to control excessive behavior. But the problem, he goes on to say, is that now those have taken over from individuality altogether, and that human nature is now threatened with being bound too tightly. He says, but society has now fairly got the better of individuality, and the danger which threatens human nature is not the excess, but the deficiency of personal impulses and preferences. Skip down a couple of sentences. And this, by the way, is one of the most important passages in On Liberty. In our times, from the highest class of society down to the lowest, everyone lives as under the eye of a hostile and dreaded censorship. We will be returning to that passage later on in this video to talk about the implications of that for Victorian fiction. Not only in what concerns others, but in what concerns only themselves, the individual or their family do not ask themselves, what do I prefer? Or what would suit my character and disposition? Or what would allow the best and highest in me to have fair play and enable it to grow and thrive? They ask themselves, what is suitable to my position? What is usually done by persons of my station in pecuniary circumstances? Or, worse still, what is usually done by persons of a station in circumstances superior to mine? I do not mean that they choose what is customary in preference to what suits their own inclination. It does not occur to them to have any inclination except for what is customary. Thus, the mind itself is bowed to the yoke, even in what people do for pleasure. Conformity is the first thing thought of. They like in crowds. They exercise choice only among things commonly done. Peculiarity of taste, eccentricity of conduct are shunned equally with crimes, until by dint of not following their own nature, they have no nature to follow. Their human capacities are withered and starved. They become incapable of any strong wishes or native pleasures, and are generally without either opinions or feelings of home growth or properly their own. Now, is this or is this not the desirable condition of human nature? And so, at this point, Mill is discussing the fact that conformity is limiting individuality, not just because people choose to follow the expectations of society as opposed to their own preferences, but because it never occurs to them to have their own preferences independent of what society expects of them. That they're so thoroughly indoctrinated into social expectations, into Victorian mores and the expectations of respectability and propriety, that it never occurs to them to think of doing anything other than that. And so society loses the advantage of individual thought and behavior. If you skip ahead to page 85, he then begins to describe what the cost is of this to society, not just to the individuals who are so bowed to the yoke by the hostile and dreaded censorship, but also its effect on people within society. First, he starts off by talking about the development of individuality. It is not by wearing down into uniformity all that is individual in themselves, but by cultivating it and calling it forth within the limits imposed by the rights and interests of others, that human beings become noble and beautiful object of contemplation. Developing individuality is what develops humans, but it also contributes to the development of society. He says, in proportion to the development of his individuality, each person becomes more valuable to himself and therefore is capable of being more valuable to others. There is a greater fullness of life about his own existence, and when there is more life in the units, there is more in the mass which is composed of them. As much compression as is necessary to prevent the stronger specimens of human nature from encroaching on the rights of others cannot be dispensed with. But for this, there is ample compensation even in the point of view of human development. Of course, it's necessary to keep excessively strong characters from infringing on the rights of other people to develop. But that limitation in itself allows for a more full development of human personality and human individuality throughout society. Let's scroll down a little bit more. Continuing his discussion, which explains why individuality is valuable to society, he says, "It will not be denied by anybody that originality is a valuable element in human affairs. There is always need of persons not only to discover new truths and to point out when what were once truths are true no longer, but also to commence new practices and set the example of more enlightened conduct and better taste and sense in human life. This cannot well be gainsaid by anybody who does not believe that the world has already attained perfection in all its ways and practices. It is true that this benefit is not capable of being rendered by everybody alike. There are but a few persons in comparison with the whole of mankind whose experiments, if adopted by others, would be likely to be any improvement on established practice. But these few are the salt of the earth. Without them, human life would become a stagnant pool. Not only is it they who introduce good things which did not before exist, it is they who keep the life in those which already existed. If there were nothing new to be done, would human intellect cease to be necessary? Would it be a reason why those who do the old things should forget why they are done and do them like cattle, not like human beings? There is only too great a tendency in the best beliefs and practices to degenerate into the mechanical. And unless there were a succession of persons whose ever-recurring originality prevents the grounds of those beliefs and practices becoming merely traditional, such dead matter would not resist the smallest shock from anything really alive, and there would be no reason why civilization should not die out, as in the Byzantine Empire. Persons of genius, it is true, are and are always likely to be a small minority, but in order to have them, it is necessary to preserve the soil in which they grow. Genius can only breathe freely in an atmosphere of freedom." So the importance of originality is the value of allowing people of genius space in which to create, not only to create new things, but also to continually recreate the existing things, that even existing practices, if they fall into merely being traditional, being done simply because they've been done before, become mechanical. But they may be valuable, and there may be reasons why one would want to continue to do those practices. And people who are constantly using their critical thinking to review and analyze behaviors are likely to keep those practices not merely from being traditional, but actually having some value to society. However, on the next page, he goes on to say that the problem is that society does not recognize the value of genius, and it does not recognize the value of people who do things that are not customary or usual or accepted. Those people are often shunned or suppressed. He says, "In sober truth, whatever homage may be professed or even paid to real or supposed mental superiority, the general tendency of things throughout the world is to render mediocrity the ascendant power among mankind. At present, individuals are lost in the crowd. In politics, it's almost a triviality to say that public opinion now rules the world. The only power deserving the name is that of the masses, and of the government, while they make themselves the organ of the tendencies and instincts of the masses. This is as true in the moral and social relations of private life as in public transactions. Those whose opinions go by the name of public opinion are not always the same sort of public. In America, they are the whole white population. In England, chiefly the middle class. But they are always a mass, that is to say, collective mediocrity. And what is still a greater novelty, the mass do not now take their opinions from dignitaries in church or state, from ostensible leaders, or from books. Their thinking is done for them by men much like themselves, addressing them or speaking in their name on the spur of the moment through the newspapers." It's amazing that he wrote this thing 150 years ago, because now with the echo chambers of social media and foolish people leading foolish people around the world, it's completely believable that he could have written this last week. The problem is, he says, that not only is individuality discouraged, but the expectations which individual members of society are expected to conform to are those that are determined by public opinion, by the collective mediocrity, which not only discourages originality, but discourages any sort of exceptionalism or any sort of behavior beyond mediocre behavior. On the next page, page 88, he makes it clear that he is not endorsing Carlyle's notion of hero worship, whereby powerful people who are capable of grabbing power therefore deserve it. He says, "I am not countenancing the sort of hero worship which applauds the strong man of genius for forcibly seizing on the government of the world and making it do its bidding in spite of itself. All he can claim is freedom to point out the way. And so genius should be allowed to express itself to other people, but genius should not be allowed to impose its will in a free society. And since this text is on liberty, and he is talking about freedom, he wants to make it very clear that he is not endorsing any sort of totalitarian oligarchy. However, he wants to make it clear that the problem of public opinion imposing behavior on individuals and restraining originality by requiring people to bow to custom limits the ability of society to move forward. The despotism of custom is everywhere the standing hindrance to human advancement, being in unceasing antagonism to that disposition to aim at something better than customary, which is called, according to the circumstances, the spirit of liberty or that of progress or improvement. The spirit of improvement is not always a spirit of liberty, for it may aim at forcing improvements on an unwilling people. And the spirit of liberty, insofar as it resists such attempts, may ally itself locally and temporarily with the opponents of improvement. But the only unfailing and permanent source of improvement is liberty, since by it there are as many possible independent centers of improvement as there are individuals. The progressive principle, however, in either shape, whether as love of liberty or of improvement, is antagonistic to the sway of custom, involving at least emancipation from that yoke. Although On Liberty throughout is a wonderful text that everyone should read, Chapter 3 on individuality as one of the elements of well-being is an important text to consider for the purposes of understanding the relationship between an individual and a society, and the threat that Victorian respectability imposes upon the possibilities of individual advancement and success. Now, another element that comes out of this chapter from On Liberty that's very important, and we will be looking at very closely throughout the rest of the semester, in fact, is the mechanism by which conformity is enforced, which most often involves surveillance. And so in order to understand how this hostile and dreaded censorship becomes an operative force in Victorian society and a shaping force for several of the texts we will be reading over the rest of the semester, we need to turn to philosopher and historian Michel Foucault and his discussion of our old friend Jeremy Bentham's idea of the panopticon. John Stuart Mill's discussion of the harsh and dreaded censorship, which enforces customary behavior through public opinion, depends upon a notion that is discussed in detail by historian-philosopher Michel Foucault in his book Discipline and Punish, in which he discusses the difference between the social organization prior to the mid-1700s, based upon what he calls a punishment society, as opposed to the social organization that evolved at the latter part of the 18th century, which he calls a discipline society. According to Foucault, a punishment society is a hierarchical society which has a very top-down model of organization. God gives authority to the nobility and the aristocracy. The nobility and the aristocracy authority is passed down to the magistrates. The magistrates pass authority to the father. The father rules over the family, and at the very bottom of the scale are the animals. It's very much a top-down hierarchy based upon a vertical linear distribution of power. However, according to Foucault, in the mid-1700s, and incidentally, I would date this change with the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, society shifted its model of power distribution. And in order to discuss this new model of power distribution, Foucault turns to our old friend Jeremy Bentham's model of the panopticon. In the panopticon, according to Jeremy Bentham, which he designed as a model for prisons, it is based upon the idea that the prison would be built in an octagonal or circular structure with cells arranged in tiers stacked one above the other along the wall. Each cell is open to the center and all of them are exposed so that they can be viewed from the middle of the building. In the middle of the building, there is an observation tower. And so from the observation tower, at any time you can see into the cells. The cells have walls that separate them from the adjoining cells, so people in adjoining cells cannot see into each other's cells. but they have bars on the front, so they're open to the front, so they can be seen into from the tower. And they have a window at the back, so they're always backlit, so that someone in the tower can look into the cell and see what's going on at the cell at any time. Now, and here's where the model becomes particularly interesting. The observation tower is encased in one-way glass, so that people within the tower can see out, but people outside of the tower can't see in. So the people in the cells never know whether they are being observed. They may be observed at any moment, but they don't know whether anyone is observing them at that particular moment. Now, this is where the model becomes interesting, because since the inmates in the prison don't know when they are being watched, and may be watched at any moment, though they're never sure, they become the people who police their own behavior. Because they're worried about the possibility they may be observed from outside, they must constantly watch themselves. The disciplinary model displaces power through the idea that you may be surveyed at any time from outside, so you end up having to watch your own behavior. Bentham, by the way, also proposed that this would be an effective model for hospitals, insane asylums, and schools. So in Bentham's model, as described by Foucault, power becomes distributed across society so that every individual person becomes a node in the distribution of power. Rather than worrying about the top-down hierarchical model in which you could be punished by someone above you on the power hierarchy, but you did not have to worry about the people at your same level, or especially the people below you because they had no power over you, in this case, you become responsible for administering power over yourself. Now, this becomes even more complicated in modern society because each individual person, as described in John Stuart Mill's notion of the harsh and dreaded censorship, becomes someone who is always observing their neighbors. The neighbors become the nodes of power. One is always being watched by the people around one, and the people around one have the ability to impose social power on their neighbors, whether through such formal means as calling the police or informal means such as shaming or shunning. So power now becomes distributed throughout society. And rather than having to just worry about our superiors, we now have to worry about our neighbors. In modern society, this is even more complicated because, of course, we're under constant surveillance all the time. All of our actions are always being recorded, whether they're being recorded without our knowledge through surveillance cameras, which are omnipresent and all over the place, from department stores and airports to our neighbors' houses, to the open spaces and even the hallways of our college, or whether we're recording our actions ourselves through social media and posting them for everyone to see. We're constantly under the gaze of those people around us who have the power constantly to, in some way or another, control our behavior and impose social power. This notion of decentralized power, in which each individual becomes a node for the distribution of this power, is essential in the novels we'll be reading in the future. We'll see it in Dickens' A Christmas Carol, and particularly with The Ghost of Christmas Yet to Come. It will become an essential model in Bronte's Jane Eyre, where people are constantly spying on each other. It's even an explicit theme in Charlotte Bronte's novel Villette, in which Lucy Snow, the main character, is teaching in a pensionnat, a school for girls, which is ruled by Madame Beck and her practices of surveillance. And it will figure also prominently in Mrs. Dalloway by Virginia Woolf, in the person of Sir William Bradshaw, who is using his sense of proportion to control the inappropriate impulses of those people like Septimus Warren Smith, for the good of society and for the happiness of their families. And very importantly, in Joseph Conrad's novel Heart of Darkness. In Heart of Darkness, he has his narrator Marlowe describe to the people who are listening to his narrative about his journey up the Congo how they, embedded within the surveillant practices of civilization, could never understand what happens to someone who is freed from the kind neighbor whispering of public opinion. You can't understand, how could you, with solid pavement under your feet, surrounded by kind neighbors ready to cheer you or fall on you, stepping delicately between the butcher and the policeman in the holy terror of scandal and gallows and lunatic asylums, How can you imagine what particular region of the first ages a man's untrammeled feet may take him by the way of solitude, utter solitude without a policeman, by the way of silence, utter silence where no warning voice of a kind neighbor can be heard whispering in public opinion? These little things make all the great difference. In Heart of Darkness, the gaze of our neighbors, of the police, and of punishment mechanisms ranging from the gallows to public opinion are what keep society going and keep individual impulses in check.